good to be here today before you and with all your holy angels. We thank you for your Holy Spirit who leads us here, Lord, and we just ask that you continue to speak to our hearts and speak through the speakers today, Lord. And we just thank you for all the wonderful music that we have here today as well. Continue to be with us and bless us, I pray, in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, this time I'm going to ask Dawn to come up. We're going to have our regular church offering at this time. Thank you.
Did you want the opening gift first?
Oh,
we have the opening gift.
Okay. Want to do the opening hymn? Okay. We're going to do the opening hymn. Glory to His name. It's in the, what is it? On page 6. Okay. Glory to His name.
Thank you.
seated. You guys sound awesome. Okay, now.
At this time in our service, we have the opportunity of sharing our tithes and our offerings. The loose offering is for our own church budget here. So at this time, we'll ask Fred and Preston to come forward to receive our offerings and tithes.
Quickly at the break there with Paul and Linda. So if I don't finish a word, join in.
Hello? Peek-a-boo? Is it on?
Yes, it is.
Still I know the rules of the world.
you, Joy. I'm looking forward to this afternoon. Supper is going to be 5 o'clock, and we're going to maybe change just slightly in our program. And we're going to have more music, songs with our musicians here. And so I'm looking forward to that. And so at this time, I invite our guest speaker, Marion, to come up, and he's going to be bringing us the message.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Well, that was good. That was excellent. As we get ready here, prepare for this presentation, I'm just so glad to be here at Port Hardy. We had such an amazing time. We are staying right next to Pastor Randy's place. And what's the name of this place again?
Scotia Bay.
Scotia Bay. Those of you who know Port Hardy, it's beautiful. As we were this morning, my boys and we went down to the ocean and just throwing rocks, and they didn't want to leave, so I said, come on, time to go. It's so beautiful. This is really God's country.
Amen.
It's just amazing. Even though they were forecasting that there's a major storm coming, but I didn't see anything. You know, maybe by the time we're done, the clouds will be angry at the sermon and things like that, you know? I want to tell you a little funny story about one preacher who preached a sermon. He preached it, he preached well, and then at the end of the service, he was shaking people's hand. And one little boy, he came to the pastor and said, Pastor, your sermon was long, too long. And the sermon, you know, the pastor was kind of, didn't feel very comfortable. And the mother of the boy was kind of embarrassed. And then the boy continued, and he says, and you were boring. Now, at this point, the pastor is uncomfortable, the mother is uncomfortable, and then the mother says, she says, Pastor, don't worry. He doesn't know what he's saying. He just says what everyone else is saying. Okay, you know, I'm looking at the clock here. It's almost 12 o'clock. You guys worship here like with no time limit, right?
Right.
All right. Okay. About 15% of you said yes. Okay, well, you know, today's message, I want to really, you know, there are sermons in my life, and this one is based on my life experiences, and I just want to just pray briefly before we start, if that's okay. Dear Heavenly Father, as I open your word, Lord, I just want your spirit to be here, Lord. While I'm speaking, may this preacher not become a stumbling block to your Holy Spirit. Thank you for being with us. And I pray, please touch our hearts in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I'm sure that many of you are quite disturbed of what is happening around the world. It was mentioned last night that we are living in the last days. And, you know, in a peaceful country like Canada, especially in Vancouver Island, sometimes it's easy to just kind of forget what's happening in the rest of the world. Because as you know, Europe is not the same. You know, I come from Europe. I visited Europe not too long ago, and I do not recognize Europe. Because as people are saying peace, peace, but there is more turmoil in Europe, and it's in almost every country. We know what happened in France. We know what is happening in England. You know, ISIL is now literally sweeping across the world. People are afraid of what will happen in North America. And that just reminds me of the Testimonies, Volume 9, pages 11 to 12. It says, we are living in the time of the end. The fast fulfilling signs of the times declare that the coming of Christ is near at hand. The days in which we live are solemn and important. The Spirit of God is gradually but surely being withdrawn from the earth. And so don't be surprised at what you see even in Fort McMurray. You know, the fires, the devastations, you know, the the global warming, even though some people say it's, you know, they don't like the term. But I can tell you this, I drove through the mountains, whatever you call it global warming or climate change, but I see that even mountains are not the same, okay? And it's not usual to have plus 32 Celsius in northern Alberta, it's not usual, okay? So no matter what you call it. And we were just there last week, we were conducting evangelistic series in Edmonton, and right when we left, we heard of all the devastations. I'm not surprised, it was so hot in Edmonton. And imagine what's happening there in the north. And so we need to keep all the peoples in prayer. But the Bible says that in addition to the natural disasters, thefts and murders are committed on every hand. Men possessed of demons are taking the lives of men, women, and little children. Men have become infatuated with vice, and every species of evil prevails. It's just the world was shocked to see what happened in Syria, what happened in Iraq, how cruel the murders were of even little children. Children crucified in front of their parents. I mean, something people have not seen for, or not have heard for a long time. It's happening. Christians are being persecuted in many countries. And even here in Canada, as I always remind my congregation that in this country, for the longest time, people are discussing removing the name God Keep Our Land from our national anthem. You know how we sing, God keep our land glorious and free. They want to replace the word God with something else. So maybe very soon we will sing, you know, Canadian dollar keep our land. I don't know, maybe some other word that will replace God. But the Bible and the spirit of prophecy predicts that in the last days, we're going to be experiencing some special times. The agencies of evil are combining their forces and consolidating. They are strengthening for the last great crisis. Great changes are soon to take place in our world, and the final movements will be what? Rapid ones. Very rapid. So that's what the Bible and that's what the spirit of prophecy predicts. So, and we can definitely see that. You know, it doesn't take a long time for the peaceful country to turn into chaos. And that's what's happening around the world. So we need to be vigilant of that as Christians. And so today's message is definitely centered about, I have different titles for this message usually. I say what it means to be spiritual, or what is spirituality all about. Sometimes I have different titles. So this morning, I want to talk about mountains, because I come from the mountains. Just in case you don't remember, I know you guys remember me as one of the three Russian boys, and that's okay, that's okay. One of you pointed out that, Marion, you are not really from Russia, and that's correct. I am not really from Russia. I lived there, you know, just like I lived in Port Hardy for about 3 months. But originally, I come from Transylvania, okay, Transylvania. So I jokingly tell my members, please do not call me after midnight. Because Dracula and me, we're kind of related, you know? Yeah, the Dracula Palace is just not too far away from where I was born. And it's Carpathian Mountains, and they're not as majestic as the ones you see here. But I love mountains. And as I read my Bible correctly, I understand that God loves mountains too. Because, you know, even mountains symbolically, in prophetic language, represent the kingdom of God. Even if you read the book of Daniel, this rock that was cut, you know, that came down from heaven and struck the big statue, it says it grew and became a great mountain. We understand that mountains symbolically represent the kingdom of God. And so I'm not surprised that one day Jesus decided to take his disciples up on the mountain, and this is what the sermon is all about. And before I preach the sermon, I have many stories. You know, I love to share stories. I'm so glad to see Richard this morning. Richard, I saw you walking last night. I just came last night. Now, those of you who do not know, when I was here 18 years ago, Richard came to our boat called Santa Rosa. He was there in the port, and Richard and us, the three Russian guys, we would have many. Many nights we would just come, drink tea, and just talk. Remember, Richard, those days? And we would discuss everything, politics, weather, religion. And Richard, it is so good to see you, you know? There's something changed about us, right? From last time we saw each other. But you know, there are some things that are the same. At least we have the same hair now, you and me. But back then, 18 years ago, you know, I'm so glad that you're here. So I love stories. One of the stories I want to share with you is that for the longest time in my life, I always heard about the great Niagara Falls. Listen, this mic, I can put it down. You can hear me all?
Yeah.
All my life, I heard about the great Niagara Falls. I heard about it, but I've never experienced it in my life. And you know, there is a big difference when you hear about something or when you experience it for yourself. So when I was growing up in Ukraine, our communist teacher was telling us, many of you are so lucky to have Adventist school here, you know, because I tell you, back home, under Soviet regime, we had no choice but go to the communist school. And our teacher used to tell us, kids, one day, Russia is going to rule the entire world, all right? She would say, even in Canada, people will speak Russian very soon. And she says, and because Canada and Russia, we are in the same part of the planet, and we have the same resources, same climate, but Canada has Niagara Falls. And I remember she was showing us this big Niagara Falls. And all my life, I said, I wish one day I could just go and just experience the Niagara Falls. And you know, my dream did come true. One day, many times I did go to the Niagara Falls, but one day back in 2010, on our 10th anniversary, me and my wife decided to go, and then we took that ride in that little boat. You see that little boat there? We decided to go there. It's kind of scary, but I want you to know, if you haven't gone on that boat ride, you have not really experienced Niagara Falls. And when I got there, and here's a video from my video camera, we were slowly coming closer and closer to the Great Niagara Falls. And I tell you, you could hear the sound, and the closer we came, the louder the roar of the falls was there. And then finally, the boat actually goes inside into that mist, and then it stops there, and then whoever, or maybe it's just a recording, but the captain says, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Great Niagara Falls. And when the captain said that, I couldn't help but kind of experience the glory of God. I don't know if that happens to you sometimes. Even the Bible says that by nature, as we look at nature, we can definitely know that there is God. And when they came and he says, ladies and gentlemen, here is the great Niagara Falls. And my eyes just filled with tears because I could just feel the great power of God because God created this. And as I stood there in the presence of this Niagara Falls, I definitely felt the presence of God there. You know, I'm so glad that I experienced that. So there's one thing to hear about it, another thing experience it. Also, all my life I've heard that there is a country that has no speed limit. And all my life, I was looking forward to go to that country and go as fast as I could. You know, because back at home, we lived in a country that really had no laws. I mean, even if policemen stopped you, you could just tell him, you know, get lost. Don't bother me. Here's $10 and please leave me alone. We kind of tried to do that in Canada when we came here, and we got in trouble because you can't do that. You can't really do that in Canada, you know? But we were learning because, you know, for us, police officers were just people that are corrupt, but not in Canada, even though there is some corruption here, but I want you to know that we're so blessed to live in this country, where police officer will never, ever take your $10 or $100. At least I haven't heard of that. And so one day we did end up in a country called Germany, and even Italy, there are some places there is no speed limit. So it's one thing to hear about it, but I tell you, it's a different experience when you get behind the wheel. And so me and my wife, we rented this little Ford Fiesta, that's all we could afford. But even that little Ford Fiesta with the little turbo diesel engine was going about 150, 160 kilometers an hour. There you see me. But believe it or not, even as you drive 160, people still pass you. I was not in the fast lane. People are like, move! And so, as you can see, I'm squeezing everything from this little Ford Fiesta. We're going 170. and Mercedes and BMW just leaving us in the dust, you know? People are going at 200, 210, 220, no problem. Oh, what an experience, you know, I tell you. I'm so thankful that God gave me those experiences in my life, because it's one thing to hear about it, but it's another thing to experience it for yourself. You know, my brothers and sisters, the reason I'm saying this is that I believe that there are many Christians who hear about Jesus Christ all their life, from kindergarten to until they're adults, but they have never truly experienced the power of God. Amen. You know, you may even have a church membership, and you may even go to church, but it doesn't mean that you have experienced the power of God. You know, one day I thought that if I buy a gym membership, that I will become more fit. And so I did sign up for one membership. It was expensive. It was like $45 a month. These days it's expensive, you know? And I thought, for sure now, I will be healthy. But you know what? I put the membership card in my wallet, and I just drove past by this gym, never really stopping by, because I had no time. Just because you have a membership in the church or membership in the gym, it doesn't mean that you have truly experienced, you know, health, or you've truly experienced Jesus Christ for yourself. You know, that's why I believe that when you open the Bible in Matthew chapter 17, Jesus decided to do something with his disciples. You know, up until now, they heard about him, that he is the Son of God, that he is the King of Kings, but they have not really experienced Jesus' glory. And so Jesus decided to take them up on the mountain. I'm sure you remember the Bible verse that says, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. Now, I have a very good explanation of why only three of them, not 12 of them, ended up on that mountain, but it's coming up. But three of them are there. And so I believe that, and many scholars believe, that the mountain that Jesus took them up on, that mountain, it's called Mount Hermon. It's also called the Sacred Mount, because this is the mount that scholars, and even biblically speaking, they believe that this is the mountain where Jesus transfigured before the three disciples. And this is what the mountain looks like. This is the true picture. It's not Rocky Mountains. This is actually in the Middle East there. You can see that this is one of the highest mountains there, and there is even a ski resort, believe it or not. We sometimes think of the Middle East as, you know, there's only sand and sand dunes and palm trees. But this is the mountain. And so Jesus went up on this mountain. In the Gospel of Luke, it says, he went up into a mountain to pray. He went to pray. And then, as it often happens, I don't know about you pastors, Pastor Rod, I don't know about you, but sometimes as a pastor, I hold a prayer meeting, and suddenly I realize that people fall asleep. Does that happen to you? And that really bothered me, Pastor Randy. Because when I was starting out in ministry, I thought, you know, that ministry is you're going to come, you're going to be a pastor, and everybody's going to be worshiping God, getting into the Spirit. But I remember my first prayer meeting, and I looked around, and half of my people were sleeping. And we did not even start. And that's why my theology professor, and Andrew, says, Marian and other pastors, just relax. Because even during Jesus' prayer meetings, people fell asleep. And he quoted this Bible verse from Luke chapter 9, verse 32. It says, Peter, John, and James, they were not just asleep. They were heavy asleep. Now, how can you fall asleep at a prayer meeting where Jesus himself is there? You know, it's possible. You know, sometimes it's interesting. People will come and say, I don't go to prayer meeting. Why? It's boring. Okay. Well, what do you want us to do? Well, I don't know, but it's just boring. You know, I'll tell you something, guys. Do you know why the church and the prayer meetings are boring sometimes? It's because I believe that just like these disciples, one of the reasons I believe we have not really looked at the church as a place that is not boring, because we have not truly experienced the glory of God. Sometimes we hear about Jesus, we talk about Jesus, we say all the holy things in the church. Sometimes we may even say, Hallelujah, praise the Lord. But the Bible says not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom. So just because we even do the holy things in the church, that still does not mean that we have experienced the glory of God. And so how do you experience that? Well, I just want you to imagine that you're up on that mountain, and all three of them are there. And, you know, and before, as I continue, I'm just reminded, one church, we did the NCD survey. I don't know if you guys did an NCD survey here in this congregation. But NCD survey is just like a survey that asks basic questions about your church so that we can evaluate the church. And so one of my churches, we had a question, Pastor Kuma, very simple question. And it was, I can easily explain why I come to the worship service. And to the shock of me and my elders, we learned that more than half of our congregation, Adventist congregation, could not answer this question. More than half of the people who filled out the survey, they could not explain why they come to the worship service. And many people were wondering, well, why is this happening? Why is that many people come to church, but they cannot answer a simple question? And I'll tell you why. Because I believe many of us go to church, but we have not really experienced the glory of God. And that's why we cannot even answer a simple question like that. How sad that sometimes it is a possibility that we can go to church for the rest of our lives and never experience the glory of God. It doesn't matter if you are very conservative, because Pharisees were very conservative. I meet a lot of people who think that in order to experience the glory of God, I have to make religion very tough. I grew up in the church like that. In Ukraine, even if you smile, a deacon would say, is anything funny? Please, this is not a funny place. You are, please, I'm going to escort you. This is not a place for laughing. Come on. That's, come on. All right, please, Andrew, thank you. I read it. I don't know about picking you all the time. Okay. This is the kind of church I grew up. That even if you smile, that means something's wrong with you. And so I have these angry people sometimes in church saying, well, yeah, you have to look serious. Okay, that's good. That means you have experienced the glory of God. Okay? And I understand. We come from different cultural backgrounds, but I want you to know that just because you're very conservative, it does not mean that you have experienced the glory of God. You know, Pharisees, they thought that they were very spiritual. They thought they have experienced the glory of God. But even Jesus was not good enough for them. Even Jesus, you know, they had to correct him. That's not how you worship. That's not how you keep the Sabbath day holy. Do you meet people like that sometimes in your life? They're always about do's and don'ts, everything. And they believe that that's how you experience the glory of God. Well, let me tell you something. When the three disciples, when they went on that mountain, you know, pretty much, I believe Jesus had to ask them a question, you know. Have you experienced God in your life? And I want you to turn to your neighbor. I don't know if you have done this before, but I like to do this in Victoria sometimes. You may be sitting right next to your wife, and that's okay. You may be sitting right next to someone you have never met before. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, have you experienced God's glory in your life? Yeah, ask.
Oh, yes.
Okay, are you? Have you experienced the glory of God? How do you answer this question? John chapter 1, verse 14. I want you to know it should not be a difficult question because the disciples actually gave a testimony. They said, we have seen his glory. Now, they may not have said it like me. Please do not misunderstand me. I like to speak from my heart. Sometimes I raise my voice. They may have said, we have seen his glory. It's not a difficult question. I know why I go to church. I know why I worship. It doesn't matter if the speaker is boring sometimes. I do not go to church because of a pastor. I do not go to church because of someone else. I do not choose when to go to church because one Sabbath I like the speaker, and another Sabbath I don't like the speaker. If you are that kind of Christian, you have not experienced the glory of God. Because you do not go to church to listen to a pastor. You go to church to worship God.
Amen.
You go to church to be in the presence of the most holy God. You go to church because you want to experience the glory of God. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, the disciples were very sure that they have seen the glory of the one and the only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Second Peter, look, now we are going to Peter. We were where? We were in John, now we're in Peter. And remember, these are the ones that, you know, Peter was there on that mountain. He says, we did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord. Because what? We were what? Eyewitnesses of His majesty. We know that He is the Son of God. We were the eyewitnesses. How many of us can really say that this is what we have experienced in our lives? Then He says, we ourselves even heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with Him, where? On that sacred mountain. So what happened on that mountain? Okay, let's just remember what happened on that mountain. Matthew chapter 17. Just then, there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Well, that's kind of supernatural, right? I mean, don't you wish that someday you would experience the appearing of Moses and Elijah? And there he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Wow, this is amazing. You know, can you imagine? Just put yourself in the place of these three disciples. You were there on the mountain, and suddenly you see this. Matthew 17:4 says that Peter, he must have lost his speech. You know, many people actually say that he was confused. He didn't know what to say. And so he said this, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Now, I want you to know that I'm going to give you a little different interpretation of why he said this. And I'll tell you why. Because when I was reading this passage, I kind of put myself in the place of these disciples. And to be honest with you, if I was Peter, I probably would have said the same thing, and I'll tell you why. Because you see, once they experience the glory of God, and if I were to experience the glory of God, and I was on that sacred mountain, I pretty much would say, Jesus, please, I want this experience to continue. I don't want this to stop. I want to be on this mountain. I do not want to go back down in the valley. I don't know about you, but down in the valley, there are things of this world. There are the credit card bills. There are the challenges, you know, the heartaches, the suffering. That's the valley. I am now having a mountaintop experience. Lord, please, don't stop. You guys sometimes have those moments when you say, Lord, please, let this good times continue. I don't want this to stop. So if I was Peter, I would say, Lord, I want to build a house here. Okay, right now, I don't want to go back down in the valley. I want to live here. Come on. I want to live right here. I don't want to go anywhere else. But here's something that disciples probably learned the biggest lesson of their life. You see, the biggest lesson of this of our lives from this mountaintop experience is that Jesus reminds us that as Christians, we need to experience God's glory in our lives. And the way we do that is by spending time with God.
Amen.
You know, you do not have to see Moses and Elijah appear to you, but I'll tell you this, if you read the Word of God, the Bible actually tells us that if we spend time with God at home, reading our Bibles, reading the spirit of prophecy, it is the same as if we are going to go and experience the glory of God. Do you know that even this world was created by God's word? Let there be light. Four words, that's it. And with those four words, God creates light. How many words from the Bible will change your life if you're going to spend some time in the Word of God? I want to tell you something. Unfortunately, I'm afraid that the majority of Christians never read their Bibles. I'm going to say this again. I honestly believe that many Adventists have not touched their Bibles in a long time. I honestly believe that many people never even read a spiritual book for the longest time. They have never reached the mountaintop experience because they're always down in the valley. They never read anything spiritual. Their spiritual man is totally empty. And therefore, the church becomes boring. The pastor becomes boring. Everything is boring. Even the prayer meeting is boring. Because in our mind, everything we think about is Netflix, Facebook, CNN, BBC. There's nothing else. Our mind, that's all it has. We are down in the valley. We have never left the valley. But God is asking us every day to go up on the mountain with Him. But we should not stay there. Oh, no. The biggest lesson that the disciples learned is that once they experience God, they need to go back down in the valley and share that experience with everybody else.
Amen.
You see, That is why Christians are not separated from this world. We are in this world, but not of this world. And so the disciples had to come down from the mountain and share this experience with them. I want you to know something. That once you experience Jesus in your life, people around you, they will notice that. They will notice that you have been with Christ. Do you know that when Moses came down from the mountain, the Bible says when Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant and they were afraid even to come near to him. Because people could see that he was in the presence of God. When you spend time in the Bible, when you read the Bible, I want you to know that there is going to be a change within you. That even you will not notice, but people will say, well, definitely, there's something about this person that is different. Something looks like this person was in the presence of God. This happened with Moses, but not only with him. Look, Acts chapter 4, it says, when people saw the courage of Peter and John, they took note that these men had been what? That these men had been with Jesus. Do you see? There's something about people who experience the glory of God. And I want you to turn to your neighbor again, please. Once again, turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. I know you're not used to this. That's okay. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. Are you awake? Thank you. And then ask, neighbor, do the people around you notice that you have been with Christ? Ask him. Do the people around you notice that you have been with Christ? Oh, I tell you, I'm going to kind of end my presentation with this story. One day, this happened in Loveland, Colorado. It was one of my destinations that I want to go there again. This is the home of HMS Richards, one of the greatest preachers in Adventism. Someone that started radio ministry, and this is where he grew up. I'm sure he was inspired by these mountains. One day I went there for the training with Amazing Facts, and many pastors came there to Loveland, Colorado to get the training. And Pastor Randy, as we were there, one day one of the local people said, hey, since you are here for like a month, why don't you climb one of the mountains here in this area? Now I got excited because I come from the mountains. And then I started to go around and I said, hey pastors, there was quite a few of them. I said, listen, let's get organized. Let's go and climb one of the summits here in the city. And to my surprise, more than half of the pastors says, no. Mary and I have no time. I need to study. I do not have time to climb mountains, okay? And listen, I come from the sea, okay? Mountains is not really my thing. So thank you very much. Then I finally ended up with at least three pastors, and I said, okay, are you guys kind of excited? They said, one of them said, listen, I will go, but only if you can wake me up in the morning. Then I asked them, how hard do you want me to try? He says, because I can really wake you up. In order to climb one of these mountains, you had to wake up at like 5 a.m. in order for you to go up and then come down. At least that's what the locals told me. Now, you know, I'm not necessarily the most organized person. I think I woke up like around 7. And I tried to wake up my pastor friend, no matter what I tried to do with him. Well, the last thing was just to pour water on him. He was not going to wake up. And so, brothers and sisters, that particular day, I understood why Jesus ended up with only 3 disciples, not 12. You know why? I'll tell you why. Because majority of people do not want to put any effort to climb any mountains. Majority of people want to stay down in the valley. And as a matter of fact, they even want you to kind of stay down in the valley as well. No one really wants you to go anywhere. So what happened is that I ended up by myself. Now please, I want to tell you something. Just because I share this story, please do not think that I'm trying to say that I'm such a great person, that I'm so organized, that my life is so together. No, to the opposite. Actually, I want you to know that I struggle with things just like everybody else. And I want you to know that my natural self, I want to stay down in the valley. I don't want to get up in the morning. As a matter of fact, sometimes I just feel that life is already busy enough. Sometimes I just wish I just had to do nothing. Pastor, do you have days like that? Sometimes I just want to turn my cell phone off. I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't want to see anybody. I just want to be by myself. You guys feel like that sometimes? So, but that particular morning, as I was reading my devotional, my Bible, I thought, you know, why don't I climb one of these mountains? Well, down deep inside, I also kind of felt like, I want to show these Americans that, you know, this guy can climb a mountain. Come on. I mean, somebody can, is there anybody? So I ended up going there by myself. And I want you to know, sometimes when you decide to leave the valley and you want to go up the mountain of God, sometimes you will have to stand alone. And there will be nobody there to sing Kumbaya for you or with you. You're going to be just by yourself. But you're not alone because God is with you.
Amen.
If you're down in the valley, and I meet a lot of people who say, I don't need to change my life. Listen, we're all like that. Everybody is doing what I'm doing, okay? I want to stay in the valley. I don't want to go up any mountain. Sometimes if you do the right thing, you can be just by yourself. And this is what happened. And so I was climbing the mountain. And I recorded this climb with my camera. I like to take pictures. So, Pastor Don, I reached my first mile in 45 minutes. And I thought I was like Rambo. You guys remember Rambo? Sylvester Stallone, I thought this is it. I even dressed like one. You should see it. There's a picture coming up. I looked like I was a soldier straight from the Russian army, just ready to. So I was climbing the mountain, mile one, and they give you this post. Apparently there was like 6 miles to go up, but of course the road is windy, so I don't remember how high the mountain was, how tall the mountain was. I don't remember, but I just remember that 45 minutes, the first mile. And I looked at my watch with great pride, and I continued to climb. Mile two, another 45 minutes. And the higher, as I was getting higher up the mountain, suddenly I was experiencing more and more of God's glory, literally, as I saw his creation all around it. Suddenly I realized that one of the reasons Jesus likes to take us out of this world so that we can see down and remember that my kingdom is not of this world. As I was getting higher and higher, I just realized that that's exactly what God was speaking to me. It says, Marian, don't stay down in the valley. The valley is not your place. Don't just follow the crowd, because everybody wants to stay in the valley. Nobody wants to do anything. Just go up. This is what spirituality is all about. And as I was going up the mountain, I'm telling you, I had this religious experience. Because I was reading the Bible and I just realized that that's why Jesus was taking them up. So they can see. Suddenly the world is not the same. Suddenly you look down on the world and you can see people down in the valley. You're up on the mountain. This was mile two. But I continued to climb. And I want you to know something difficult happened around mile three. As I reached mile three, the terrain got really rough. Do you see this? This was the path around mile three. And Pastor Don, honest truth, this was the time, you know, the locals told me, you know, prepare yourself, you know, get some water, get some food. And, you know, I'm Russian, right? I don't like people telling me things. Anyways. So I had nothing, literally, just a little bit of water. By the time I reached mile three, and by this time, I want you to know, I was not walking. I was literally crawling because the hill was steep and you cannot just walk. I literally was crawling and I'm like, no. I need to go back down. I'm not gonna make it. And I was just sitting there and just weeping. Literally. I said, no, this is why did I do this? I'm not gonna get back on time. And I was just sitting on the rock, just getting discouraged. And then as I was doing that, suddenly I heard some sounds. Now I remember distinctly 18 years ago when we came to Port Hardy, we were camping outside. And I think it was James who told us, guys, you're doing what? Camping? You know, we have cougars around here. And I will always remember that. And suddenly, I'm by myself, suddenly I hear some noise. Now, trust me, even though I was dressed like Rambo, I looked like I was ready to conquer the world, but I really got scared. I thought, what is going on? And suddenly, to my shock and amazement, there I am, you see? I'm taking pictures, I'm ready to go down. I'm discouraged already. I'm not gonna reach the summit. And then suddenly, I see this guy. Now, trust me, when I saw this guy, I was not happy. I was kind of angry. Because I thought this guy was showing off. Because this guy
He was not walking, Pastor Randy. No. You know what he was doing? He was running up the hill. And I was watching him because I thought, I'm sure he's doing this just to impress me. It's just a look, you know, how cool I am. Oh, I sat there, and I thought to myself, I just didn't see this. This is not normal. And sure enough, look at this. You know, the further he went away, he continued to run up the hill. Now, by this time, remember, I'm crawling. So I said, no. I'm going to continue. Come on. So I get myself together, and I'm starting to continue to climb. After about an hour, I see this guy is coming down the same way.
And you know me,
those of you who know me, I say, okay, this is enough. I stop him. I say, okay, stop. I said, listen, who are you, man? Like, seriously? I said, how far? How much more? How much more? He says, it's just another half a mile. It's already there. I said, but listen, you were running up and down. I said, tell me a little bit more. I said, well, what is this? He says, oh. He says, some of us who live here, we do this every day. And he says, it takes me about 2.5 hours to go up and down. Now, when he said that, I thought to myself, wow, Lord, thank you for this experience. Because, you know, in my life, there were times when I wanted to quit church. There were times when I wanted to say no to Christ. There were times when I said, this is it. And I want you to know one of the reasons I almost left the church, because my church back home was extremely legalistic, to the point that you were not good enough for anything. I almost left the church. But thank God for champions of faith.
Amen.
And there are people probably here in this community who probably you can see that they have experienced the glory of God. And they are the ones that give us encouragement. I know they are the strong ones. And sometimes when they run, spiritually speaking, they see someone on the sideline, and this is a Christian thing to do, and just say, listen, don't give up. Come on, it's just another half a mile. You're almost there.
Amen.
You know, God bless you. I'm sure that if I asked you here in Port Hardy of who are your spiritual leaders here, of people that you're inspired, you know, it doesn't have to be necessarily an elder. It doesn't have to necessarily be only the pastor. It can be anybody in the community. Sometimes it can be a person that is already 90 years old, and they can give you so much boost, spiritually speaking. They say, don't give up. Continue the climb. Don't give up. And then he went running, and I said, Lord, thank you. Because it also reminded me that in order to be like him, that means what? That I would have to choose to exercise, spiritually speaking, right? I would have to do this every day. And that's why many people quit church, because sometimes they hit the rough terrain and they give up on God. But you know what? And that's why many people never truly experience the glory of God, because they never really reach the summit, the very top. They give up too early. But I want you to know, don't give up. Continue the run. Because once you reach the top, I want you to know, you will experience the glory of God.
Amen.
You know, as a matter of fact, mile 4, the higher I was getting close to the very end, the more I could see the beauty of God's creation and the beauty of God. And I want you to know the same thing is in Christian life. The more you spend time with God, the more you're going to be filled with spiritual muscles, the more you will be able to go up and down, up and down. And when you go down, you tell the people in the valley that it's worth to go up. Let's go up. You tell everybody around you, because you have been there yourself. Oh, what a beautiful place, the top of the mountain. And when I reached the top, there were these piles of rocks. And in the middle of these piles of rocks, there was this cylinder. And when you open the cylinder, many people leave notes inside of that cylinder. And they write things like, I don't know, honey, I love you, or whatever. Some even left a prayer request. I decided to write something in that cylinder as well. And you know why? Because one day, I want to take my children, my two boys, up on the same mountain. And I want them to also learn the spiritual lesson of reaching the top of the mountain, not to give up. And hopefully Dad's note, that's already several years old, as we open that cylinder, hopefully somewhere there, we will be able to find what Mary and Kosovan wrote, so that my boys, they can see that my religion is real, it's authentic, it's not fake. That even this mountain, on this mountain, their father was thinking about God. That everything in life is about valley and the mountain, and we have a choice whether we stay in the valley or go up in the mountain. I want my children to experience that one day, because you know, this is what I wrote. I said, Mary and Kosovo, this day reminds me of another mountain we all can choose to climb, the mountain of God's kingdom. May God help us all in reaching that goal. Amen?
Amen.
You know, my friend Sala is going to sing a song. I know that she, without even knowing, she prepared this song, and the name of the song has to do with mountains, believe it or not. We did not even rehearse. She knows the song. But I want you to know, as Sala sings this song, listen carefully. Maybe there is someone in this congregation that feels that God is calling you to leave the valley and start climbing the mountain. You are not perfect. You may have challenges, but you want to start that journey. Maybe there's someone here. I don't know. Maybe it's a young person. Maybe it's someone who is older. As you hear Sala sing, maybe some of you may even want to come and join us here at the platform. Now, that's again, if God is speaking to your heart. If you feel that God says, step out from the valley, it's time to go up the mountain. If that's your desire, please listen to the song and please come and join us here. Maybe there is one person, Pastor Randy here, that needed to hear this message of encouragement and start climbing the mountain, because there is life eternal at the end. Let us listen to the song. And those of you who want to come, please join us here. We will have a special prayer for you, if there is one. Thank you.
Some days I look down
Casella. You know, I definitely, we have, Rustin just came up and says, Pastor, I feel God is calling me to climb up the mountain. God bless you, Rustin. You know, you may be sitting there, and I just want you to just bow our heads as we're going to pray. And especially we're going to pray for Rustin as he is making that decision today to climb the mountain. Lord, as we pray to you this morning, we thank you for that experience and the lesson that you gave to your disciples to go up that mountain where you transfigured before them. Lord, we thank you that your kingdom is not of this world. And Lord, we do understand that for time being, we are still here in this valley until you come again. But Lord, we don't have to stay in the valley. Daily, we can reach the mountain by spending time with you in your word and in prayer. And Lord, right now, as Rustin came up here this morning, and he wants to make a decision to leave the valley in many ways, Lord, I'm sure that for him, spiritually speaking, he knows exactly what needs to be done. So Lord, empower him, strengthen him. May he receive encouragement on the way out. May he be able to see Jesus in faces, in churches that where he attends, Lord. Lord, we especially pray here that people will be able to see the glory of God in us as they interact with us. This is my sincere prayer, Lord. Bless this congregation. Continue to bless this city. May your glory be revealed to more people so that more people can choose to remember that their kingdom, their citizenship is not from here, but it's from the city called Jerusalem that is not from this world. Lord, thank you for this, for reminding us that this is where our home is. We pray to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit wonderful. I'm sure you all have experienced that, and we're, you know, like the song lined up with the message. You know, and we don't know, we just go and do our stuff. And how many times have we seen, especially as pastors and speakers in the churches, where, you know, sometimes I felt like, oh Lord, I don't know if this is the message. Or I felt afraid sometimes to bring some messages, but you know, when we follow the Holy Spirit, we'll never go wrong. And I just love it that the Holy Spirit is here today. So we're gonna have our closing hymn. There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. It's in the bulletin.
Thank you.
Father, it's so good to be here. Lord, may we always experience or daily experience this journey to the mountain where we can be close to you. Lord, I just thank you for the blessings of your Holy Spirit here today. Bless everyone, Lord, as we continue on in the next part here. And we just want to thank you for everything. In your name we pray. Amen.